Okay, so it appears that I'm live. So, hi everybody, it's Ryan Pankhost, and I'm going to do a live painting. Hopefully finish it up, but I'll just get as close as I can, as I can get it. While everyone's just tuning in, I'm going to go over the equipment that I'm using. This is a canvas, a stretched canvas. The brand is Centurion LX. It's from Creative Mark, linen stretched canvas. You can see it's on a stretcher bar. It has a very nice kind of fine surface. But I've also put a layer, or actually many layers, of Jerry's Artorama gesso on it. I laid down the gesso horizontally and then let it dry, sanded it down, did it vertically, sanded it again, and just repeated that process probably, I don't know, 5 or 6 times. You can hardly see the grain of the canvas anymore. So that's the surface that I'm working on, just the gesso. And over here at my table, I have a relatively large wood easel that I got from a photo retoucher that retired, in addition to this little table here. So I've got my palette. I've got a couple jars on the table. I have a jar of Gamsol, which is going to be my thinner. I have a jar of Terpenoid Natural, which I use to wash my brushes. And I have a tin can that I'm going to pour the Gamsol in. And then this yogurt container is for scraping off the excess paint on my palette at the end of the night. So I'm going to pour the Gamsol into my tin cup, and what has happened is the pigments from the last time I used this have settled to the bottom, so I'm going to pour off the clean Gamsol into the tin cup. And then once everything, at the end of the night, this is going to be cloudy and murky, so I'm going to pour it back in, the pigment's going to settle, and you're going to have clean Gamsol in the morning. I have some rags to wipe off the paint, and I'm using, for protection on my hands, I'm using these Elastex powder-free nitrile examination gloves that I got from a tattoo supply place, and they're relatively comfortable. And then over here I have my mediums that I'm going to use. I'm not going to use all of these, but I generally use these. This is the refined linseed oil, liquid fine detail, and artist painting medium. I'm probably just going to use linseed oil tonight. There's no need to use anything fast drying because it's going to be another month before this thing goes on sale. I have my collection of brushes, palette knives here, and a little cup to hold the medium. I also have a little pair of tweezers because I do have cats, and so I'm going to need to pick out hairs. Probably not in this painting, but like for a magic card or something high detail, I would probably need to do that. I'll show you, let's see how many people are watching. 11 people watching, that's enough. So here's what we're going to do tonight. You guys are going to pick my palette. So in the chat box, type either red, yellow, or blue. And if you're first person to do that, you can choose from the palette listed in the video description. So I'll let you guys sort that out. I'll tell you who has the first comment for the red, the blue, or the yellow. And I'm a little bit nervous, so I'll be drinking this foolproof, robust porter. 'cause this is like performing live, and I'm not a good live performer. nobody has done a text yet, or a... So I might be doing a, choosing my own. But I'll go over the photo reference. So I'm going to do a general portrait tonight. It's going to be kind of simple. I had a model come over. Oh, there we go. All right. So Dominic gets blue. Sam. Yeah, there we go. Let me just... All right, so now you guys So now you guys can choose from the pigments on the list. The portrait tonight, I'm going to do an elf, kind of just a general fantasy elf, kind of Lord of the Rings style. Let me show you the photos that I'm working with. I had a model come over, so I'm gonna, I printed out the reference really big, so it's, you know, I think this is gonna make a good, for a good portrait, but then I also printed out a reference that was really darker, than, I need, and so, because what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna start darker and then work lighter, so this really gives an idea about what the actual, structure of the face is like. Let's see. What else can I go over? Looks like it's CAD. It's gonna be cadmium red deep. Ultramarine blue deep. Oh wait, no. Who has dragon has? Try to figure this out. Okay, yeah, so Dominic, ultramarine blue deep. And. Okay. Oh, alright, Sam was supposed to pick out the yellow, but it doesn't matter. Alright, so we're going with ultramarine blue deep, alizarin crimson, and Naples yellow. Alright, that's interesting. So thank you guys, that's great. Alright. I have my basket of pigments here. Let's pick out Naples yellow. Here's the Naples yellow. Alizarin crimson and Naples yellow. Alizarin crimson, okay. Yeah. Alright, good. Okay, so we're on track, I think. So we got ultramarine blue deep, Naples yellow, and alizarin crimson. So here's the palette that I work with. It's just a some sort of a fiberglass. It used to be clear, now it's not. And so I'm gonna have the ultramarine blue deep. Naples yellow. I don't really use alizarin crimson that much, so the top is fused onto the tube. Okay. And then I'm going to be using this Michael Harding's titanium white. In addition to those three colors you guys picked out. Alright. So we got titanium white, ultramarine blue deep, Naples yellow, and alizarin crimson. I'm going to start with the gam saw, which is in my tin cup here. I'm going to use this flat brush. It's a silver bristle-on brush, and it's great for laying in the initial layer. Later, I'll be moving into these, what are these called? Get one of them. The silver white brushes. And a lot of it's going to be done, though, by this Rosemary & Company Long Flats and Long Filberts, the Master Series. So those are really nice. I'll just pour out my little bit of my linseed oil into the small cup. There. And I will try to keep an eye on the chat and also, and so I'll try to answer questions. Okay, yeah, so I'm going to try to answer questions as I can. I'll probably repeat the question and then answer it rather than type it in the comment section, understandably. So, I'm just taking a lot of Gamsol. It's really loaded up. And the issue is, where do I start? I'm thinking the Ultramarine Blue Deep and the Alizarin Crimson are going to be... They're both relatively, or they're semi-transparent. The Naples Yellow is very opaque. So the shadows are going to be all Ultramarine Blue Deep and Alizarin Crimson, probably. And then, by the looks of it, I might use the Naples Yellow for some of the gold jewelry, maybe. But it's going to be largely Ultramarine Blue Deep and Alizarin Crimson. Which is fine. Because the model's hair is purple, so that'd be kind of interesting. So, you can see I'm taking a lot of the Gamsol. With the Ultramarine Blue Deep and the Alizarin Crimson, that makes it really, really dark. That's going to make it very, very close to dark. Alright, so that's all mixed up. And, alright. You know what? I think I'm gonna tape up the reference rather than hold it. I might hold it later. But I'm gonna tape it up just so I don't have to hold the palette and the reference at the same time. So, silver white, or silver bristle on brush, flat, size 6. So, that is a very deep purple. That's going to be interesting. You know what? I'm going to do it a little more loosely. Rather than try to draw it out, I'm just going to feel around the canvas. Where I want the main figure to be. You know what, I'm going to switch to a bigger brush because I want to get even more loose. I really want the shadows to be, the light in this is going to be pretty cool. So, the shadows are going to need to be pretty warm. So I'm going to beef up the Alizarin Crimson a little bit. Alizarin Crimson is not one of my go-to colors. Because I heard somewhere it's not really like light fast, so, or not as light fast as other pigments. So I tend not to use it, but. It's a remnant of an older palette. You're still just using gam salt. Just kind of feeling out where I feel like things should be. There's the midline of her face. There's her eyes. Neckline. Bring her hands. Her face is probably still too big on her second hand. So that's kind of the outline of where most of the action in this painting is going to be happening within that border. I'm going to try to get the size of the head and the face right. So I'm going to take just straight gam sol and start to erase. You can see with the gam sol, you can get pretty close back to the white canvas. I took piano lessons when I was younger, and I could always get the pieces really, really well at home, and then at the recital, just your hands start shaking and just never turned out well. Everybody always says, oh, you did such a great job, and you know, your parents are always supportive, but you know, you didn't really do it as well, and I feel like this is gonna end up that way. But hey. I'm going to take my rag here. All right. So, Dragon is asking, what's your main advice for practicing color? How can I overcome my fear of color? I started with color wheels. So the colors that I had on hand, I just kind of started playing around with them. I didn't really buy any extra colors. I just took the colors that I had and made some color wheels, saw how the colors kind of interacted. I made a color chart to say, ultramarine blue deep and cadmium red light, they create like a very pale or very dull purple, while a combination like this, the ultramarine blue deep and the Elysian crimson, make a very vibrant purple. And so just comparing those colors together kind of gave me an idea about where which colors would produce the best secondary and tertiary colors. So yeah, color wheels help. I didn't never really took any color theory, really. But you kind of get to the point where you realize that color is all subjective, and there really is no wrong color. I mean, there's better color for a certain situation, but there's nothing wrong. There's no wrong color. It's all about how the colors play off of one another. Like right now, I know, like, because you guys picked the color, so I know this purple is going to be very, very vibrant in the piece. And so what I want to do is I really want to play up that, and that's going to make the yellow, when I use it, really pop. A lot of it comes from experience, but a lot of it just comes from knowing that whatever you put down, if you play the colors off one another enough, it's gonna look right. So shouldn't worry too much about it. So, I'm having trouble with her, because I want to get her hands in here, but I think her face is too big. And another one of my tools is this hand mirror. So I'll be constantly checking my work from the flipped orientation. If you're working digitally, you can just do that in Photoshop, just flip it around and start working backwards, as it were, but if you're working with on a painting, it's useful to have a hand mirror, so because you can easily see exactly what you're doing wrong. Not what you're doing wrong, I shouldn't say that. Exactly what needs to be improved in your drawing. I'm getting a lot of, these aren't the best rags, so I'm getting a lot of fibers in this. I'm still using Gamsol. And I would like to get a good outline of where all these forms are going. I'm just really having a kind of a hard time figuring out how our hands are going to fit into this mess. The neck, shadow of her neck goes like that, and the profile of her face is kind of like out this way. That would mean, based on my photo reference, I'm just checking the spaces. That would mean that the neck comes down this way. The neck is about that. Fur coat comes down like that. Hand is out in line with her nose. I mean, her hand is all the way out here. I'm not sure I want her hand all the way out there. But maybe that's just where it's going to be. This is not permanent, because what I'm trying to do is just make sure that I'm really just not going off the canvas in any serious way, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back and start from the eyes and work out, and so that's going to basically give me another shot to kind of get the size relationships right. I just would prefer to not have to change things. The thickness of the hand is roughly equivalent to the distance between the underside of the nose and the bottom of the chin. It's not always accurate, because there are like heroic proportions, and sometimes you don't want to make a woman's hands look too big, depending on what you're going for, but that's generally a good gauge. And right now her hands are very big, so their hands are very big. But that's fine. That's better than That's better than having them too small, because I was worried about... I was worried about having enough room for them, and apparently I will. My son is sleeping. Put him to bed around 6:30, 7 o'clock, and so I have the monitor behind me, so you might hear him cry or stir. If anything too serious happens, I will have to cut it short, but that's looking okay. Really nothing too impressive about this drawing. It's kind of like how everybody starts. I'm still not using any of that Naples yellow. I'll probably save that for the end and do when I'm creating browns, and I'll create everything together. Use all the pigments together. It's looking okay. My face is still probably too far to this side, but that's alright. Just to figure out where her ear is going to be. And she's an elf, so I'll make it pointy like that. I don't want to start too light, so so I might need to go in and darken everything. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use a little less Gamsol, because I'm not going to refill my brush. I'm just going to continue drawing like this. So the more I mix, the less saturated the paints are going to be with the Gamsol. So the thicker the paint's going to get, until I'm not really using any Gamsol at all. It's just, until it's just straight paint, and then at the end, kind of use the linseed oil. All right. So, the top of her head and the underside of her chin are going to be pretty dark, especially the underside of her chin here. She's going to have a little bit of light emanating off her face, but for the most part, this is going to be a pretty dark shadow, so I'm just going to start putting that in now. It's still relatively translucent paint, so I don't need to worry too much about it being too thick, because that's the fear with laying in the darks, is that you get ridges and in your paint, and then that reflects light, and then your dark areas aren't as deep as they need to be in order to be effective. But I'm still, even though I haven't refilled my brush with Gamsol, it's still pretty thin paint. And with a limited palette, going back to colors again, it's all about recognizing what you have and playing that up. So in this case, it was easy. As I mentioned before, the ultramarine blue and the alizarin crimson, I know, are going to create my darks. But the only way I know that is by practicing and by doing color wheels and color grids. So I know that for this part, I'm not going to add the Naples yellow because it's just too opaque, it's too light, so it's not going to do any good in the shadows. It's just going to muddy things up. So we're going to keep these shadows pure. Now, I'm going to look at the reference again and try to get the outline of her face the correct shape. This is the same thing that I'd be doing if I was painting from a live model. Except I might be a little less obsessive about it and probably a little quicker. In this instance, the face is pretty easy. Because her face is so light and the hair is so dark that it creates a really strong outline of the shape of the face. So I'm just kind of looking at the photo reference and recreating the shape of her face. So I'll just show you. So her face is kind of framed by her hair. So it's this shape right here that I'm going to try to get right. And that comes, the ability to do that, I don't have it down perfectly, but that's another thing that just comes with practice. This ability to recognize negative shapes and positive shapes and reproduce that on the canvas. Face is too, as I suspected, too thick right now. Just going slow because I'm really trying to get this shape right. Chin comes down like this. It's looking more close to what I need. Her face is basically going to be this entire project. Everything else is going to be kind of freeform. Even her hands, I imagine that they're not going to take up that much time. But the face is just so complex and so essential that most of my efforts are going into painting the face. I can use my finger at this point because I'm wearing gloves. And sometimes it's nice to be able to have that sculptural feel or the sculptural quality to the way you work. You can kind of push things around with your fingers as if you are sculpting it. And sometimes that helps. It helps me anyways. Getting it closer. And now I'm checking out the shape of her forehead. So the distance between her hair and her eyebrows. And I'm looking at that shape. in trying to mask out that shape. And that kind of informs where the eyebrows are going to go. The top of her eyelashes, the angle looks like they are kind of in line with this opposite eyebrow. So if I imagine a line kind of coming down like this, like that, your eyeball or iris is going to be like right there. This is just kind of a loose drawing. It's still pretty thin paint. So since I'm not using black, this blue and this red are my blacks, which is a nice black to have because you can push it to the cool side, to the ultramarine blue side, or you can push it to the alizarin crimson side, the warm side. And I'm going to try to push it, warm towards the alizarin crimson because the light is going to be so cool. If I were painting this as a professional job, I might do a burnt umber and an ultramarine blue deep, or a burnt umber and even a cobalt to start instead of the alizarin crimson. But that's just for professional jobs. For this, limited palette actually makes things faster because there's fewer decisions to make. There's only one way in this piece to get warmer, and that's to add more alizarin crimson. Because I've kind of ruled out the Naples yellow for this part. So I'm going to be talking a lot, so feel free to mute me if I'm getting too annoying. Oftentimes this is an easier way to draw, because you're dealing more with the forms than a line. But it's a confidence thing more than anything else. And I certainly wouldn't do this for a professional job. I'd definitely draw it all out. Checking out the reference again, and it looks like the edge of her mouth is kind of in line with the middle of her eye. So the end of her mouth is going to be right about there. Okay, so the question is, have I always been done oils, or did I start in another medium? I started in another medium. When I was in high school, actually when I was in middle school, I had an interest in art and thought I was going to be like a computer animator or something. Probably would have made more money had I done that. But my parents were always very supportive, and my dad found this guy who taught art lessons near me. His name is Bob Borowski, and he still has a school in Connecticut. And so that's from middle school, maybe even sixth grade on. And starting around high school, I really started seriously taking his adult classes, doing very structured, not really structured, but just very intense still life drawings in pencil. So you'd set up a bag, like a paper bag, and he'd draw that paper bag week after week, an hour and a half at a time, until he got it completed. So I have a collection of graphite drawings, one of a bag, one of a rock, a tea kettle. So I learned with pencil and then progressed to colored pencil, because that's the kind of like the next step to adding color. But you know, I was always do watercolors in art and like in school art class. So colored pencil was my main medium. I did a lot of drawings that were relatively successful using colored pencil. So in college, I just kept with that. I did most of my assignments using colored pencil or pastel, which is another thing that I used, or a combination of like a watercolor wash with colored pencil lines. And that persisted pretty much throughout my college career. I didn't really start in oils. I took a couple classes in college, but I didn't really start really exploring it until after college. The first jobs out of school were small spot illustrations for little magazines, because I sent out a mailer, and the only hits that I ever got were from small magazine publishers like Yankee Magazine and that kind of thing. And so I did a couple spot illustrations for them using watercolor washes and colored pencil. And then I started, through a random personal connection, a high school connection, started doing work for a game company called Fifth Epoch Publishing. And they produced a game called Metal Magic and Lore. And they liked my work because I didn't have any fantasy in my portfolio, and they really wanted to see what a non-fantasy person would do with a fantasy job. So I spent a lot of time doing watercolor, colored pencil, pencil drawings of helmets and swords and shields, and then progressed to monsters. And then once that job was completed, they were shopping their own game around, and they took me to Gen Con. And Gen Con was really like where I was kind of like, wow, I could sink my teeth into this industry, because it's something that I was always kind of interested in anyways, you know, comic books, that kind of thing, but never really considered for myself. And everybody, if they were working traditionally, were working in oils. So I was like, well, I have to beef up my oil skills. So that was around 2007, 2008. And so basically the entire calendar year of 2008, I revamped my entire portfolio, which was just watercolor and colored pencil drawings, into an oil painting portfolio. And I was living with my parents at the time. It was after college, but before I was on my own. Unfortunately, they allowed me to live there and learn oil paints for a long time. Checking the width of her hand here. That's still too big, but that's okay. It's better bigger, because I can pare it down. So 2008 was really where I started taking oils seriously. I did a lot of personal pieces in 2008. So I came back to Wizards at the next Gen Con, and John Shindahedi liked my stuff, and so he passed my name along to Jeremy Jarvis, and I started working in Magic, doing oils. It was a long process to oils, but it's actually where I feel more comfortable now. Alright, so that looks like that's a pretty good drawing. That's pretty much where I want everything to be. I'm just gonna check in the mirror. Yeah, that's alright. Alright. Retool a little bit here. So the next step is going to be, what putting some white into this mixture. So I'm gonna, let's see. Sometimes you just have to pause and think about what you're gonna do next. I'll try to keep the background as loose as I can, so. Same brush, I'm not really going to be doing any finessing right now, so we've got 47 minutes in or something, so let's get moving. Time flies, man. Oh my goodness. Alright, so since the shadows are going to be warm, as I mentioned, and the light is going to be cool, I'm going to mix some titanium white and this blue-red mixture, but kind of err on the side of the red. And I'm going to go darker than I need to be. Much darker. And so for this stage, so here's where the ugly stage happens. Artists out there will recognize the ugly stage. That's too dark even for me, I think. A good way to figure out how dark or light to make things is to recognize what makes your darkest dark. Darkest dark here is the ultramarine blue and the alizarin crimson. Fortunately, what we have in the photo reference is extreme dark in her hair next to some white skin. So what I'm going to do here is get as dark as I can possibly get. And since, the great thing about the limited palette is that since my darks are all the sort of colors that are going to be making up a lot of my lights, it doesn't matter if the darks kind of blend in with the lights. Whereas if you were using black, or using a completely separate combination of colors in your darks and in your lights, you'd be very, very careful about it. But here, alright, so, that's about as dark as I can make it. So now, I can go in, add a little white. Can see still trying to be cognizant of the drawing that I laid down, trying not to lose it. I want to go a little bit lighter just so I can see. But I'm still using largely alizarin crimson. Alright. Sam says, thanks for such an in-depth answer. Well, I have nothing else to do, Sam, so so I'm just going to keep talking. B.A., do you have any of the oil paintings from your portfolio that you got in Magic on your site? Yes, I do, I think. I did a piece with Red Riding Hood. I think that's still on my site. If you Google my name, it's still a painting that comes up often. And frankly, I had a lot of Western stuff in there, too. I think that stuff is still on my site. The one with the two guys shooting, and the one with the guy being shot in the gut, in the snow. That was on there, I know. But I don't recommend doing that, because often art directors really can't look past that kind of stuff. If you're trying to do fantasy, you should have a fantasy portfolio, but I don't know. The art directors at art directors at Wizards were a pretty smart bunch, and so they're kind of able to look past the genre and look towards the technique, which is really what they're after, because they're trying to create a cohesive look. So they need people that can produce the look they're going for. There's really no, if you've noticed, a lot of people really can't tell the difference between one magic artist and another nowadays. I can. I know a lot of people can, but often that's what people often say is that, you know, they all look the same. Well, that's kind of what they're going for. It creates a better product. So you kind of have to produce what they already have out there. Try not to make her chin. I know you're being sincere, Sam. I was being self-deprecating, but I know you're sincere. All right. So basically what we have here is ugly painting. But I've laid down some paint, at least, and I can still see where I drew the really light watery drawing. So as long as I can see those things, you know, it's good, because I was avoiding kind of like the avoiding the drawing lines as much as I can. So here I'm just kind of scumbling in more areas where the hand is. Now I'm just basically using titanium white in a limited fashion here, but I'm avoiding putting the titanium white where I know my darks are going to be, like in her hair. Because I want, when I go back to the hair at the final, I want that to be pristine. I don't want any titanium white muddying up what I want to be really, really rich blacks. So, just avoiding that as much as I can. Alright. It's still looking okay. I'm going to add a little bit of Gamsol mixture to kind of balance out the drawing as a whole. I love abstraction, I'm just not good at it yet. I would love to be able to create something that looks like it just kind of happened, but everybody wants to do what they can't do, so I'm sure the people that I admire and be other people too, so. Alright. If I don't screw it up, it should be a pretty good painting. Hope I can preserve some of the raw color that's happening in here, because I like what kind of just accidentally happened, where I have blue up here and red down here. That's kind of nice. So I hope that stays, but we'll see. So, now I've progressed enough that I'm going to start working the details. I'm wondering if I should move the camera closer. I might do that. I don't know. Maybe I will. You guys don't need to see me. Another Dragon's asking another question. Do you make color comps for your professional projects? Absolutely, I do. I do color comps digitally, and then I also do numerous color comps traditionally. So I have a lot of 5x7 canvases, so I'll lay out a palette like this. Colors that I think I'm going to use based on the prompt. It's just a guess. I'll use it, basically paint the entire painting at a 5x7 size, not very detailed. But by that point, you can kind of figure out whether or not you like the colors you chose. And if the red is too intense, just do another one. Do another 5x7 painting with a less intense red. And just kind of pare it down. It usually takes 3 tries for me to get something where I'm like, okay, that's a good palette. I like the way that yellow looks. I like the way that red looks. So I usually have to do like 3 5x7 paintings. And as I said, they're not very detailed. Alright. As for models. Alright. Ethan is asking, as for models, do you always have some specific aspects which you're looking for each project? Well, this one, I didn't really have, there was no guideline. So I basically just needed somebody that could come over and take pictures. So it really didn't matter what they looked like. But often you are kind of trying to create some sort of look based on the assignment. So I'll choose models based on the look that I'm trying to create. So it's a combination of both. I use modelmayhem.com and to find models, or I'll just get a friend or a family member to pose, although my friends and family members are getting kind of tired of posing. So now I'm taking my Rosemary & Company Master's Touch, I think, long flat, or this is a long filbert. I've loaded it up with some titanium white, not really, and kind of like the same combination of colors, erring on the side of the alizarin crimson. And I'm just using, looking at the photo reference, I'm just going to start lighting up some things. These are not final highlights. This is just going one step lighter. I'm trying to lay down my brush strokes in a manner that highlights the forms of the face. So kind of in a sculptural manner, like, for instance, if I go down to this hand, I'm going to try to lay strokes down so that they go, like even in bones or tendons that run this way down the hand, I'm going to try to lay down my color strokes going across the hand this way, which is going to create a shape to the hand, rather than creating the individual muscles and tendons. Really, that's what you're dealing with. You're dealing with shapes. And right now, I'm kind of sculpting the shapes. I'm interpreting what I see in the photographs as planes in a 3D environment, and kind of laying my brushwork down perpendicular to those planes. And you can see I'm not too concerned about mixing pristine colors. Part of the way you create nice brushwork is by not over mixing your paints, letting some of the paint mix on your board or your canvas. Your nose is slightly redder than the rest of your face, so I'm just indicating that with a little bit more alizarin crimson. And then the highlight under her nose, although not, don't go crazy with it, is a little more blue. So I'll just mix a little more blue with that combination. That's actually a little crazy. Side of her nose is going to be a little bluer too. A little highlight on the inside of her eye is going to be blue as well, or bluer. The main highlights are going to be ultramarine blue. This side of her face. The colors, in the photo, the shadows underneath or down along her chin line are cooler generally than her skin tone. But for now, I'm not going to make them cooler. I'm going to make them warmer. I want to give her some warmth and not go too crazy with the coolness. Even though there's a lot of cool reflected light, I want to kind of beef up the warm shadows. Warm shadows with a cool highlight often look more appealing to me. Because what happens is, as your skin gets hit by the sun, it just becomes a less lighter, less vibrant version of your skin tone. So your shadows are going to be generally darker and warmer. People often say, you know, warm light, cool shadows, cool light, warm shadows. That's not always how it works. Even though it's a good guide, it's not always how it works. And I find that cool light, warm shadow is a nice way to go. The great thing about these Rosemary and Company brushes is that they're not perfect. I mean, they're perfect for my uses, and they are astoundingly good brushes. However, not every hair is in line. You get these little remnants of hairs that are on the outside, and that if you can use that effectively, it's really, really nice. Work on her ear too. This is going to be, as I already put down here, kind of a warmer shadow and a cooler. So I'm just going to go cooler with the highlights. That might be all I need to indicate the ear. Probably not. I'd probably go a little more detailed, but alright, so it's already shaping up. I'm liking this. I really want to make her hair as magenta as I can. So that means playing up a little bit more of the yellow of her face. So I might start to add some Naples yellow now. We'll see. let's start. I'm kind of liking this thing as a whole, so. Now, for the sake of time, I'm going to start with this eye and radiate out. Because, you know, the stuff that's going on here is nice enough. If I can get some sort of resolution in her face, everything else can be kind of abstract. Doesn't matter at all. So that's where I'll begin. I'm going to start really concentrating here and getting her eye right. So I'm going to go back. Now I have a smaller Rosemary & Company brush. It's a long filbert. No, this is a long flat. So I'm taking the Alizarin Crimson and the Ultramarine Blue Deep again. And the good thing about these rosemary brushes is that this is a flat brush. It's very very soft. But if you load it up with paint, you can kind of drag it across the canvas this or the palette this way. You have a nice sharp edge here that you can draw with. What I tend to do, rather than use a Mahl stick, I will use a Mahl stick, but for something like this, which the background doesn't really matter, I'll just hold my pinky out here. You've seen this before if you've seen me work, and just kind of use that to kind of steady my hand. And what I'm doing here, I'm just drawing her eye. Where was her eyebrow? Her eyebrow was there. Her other eyebrow comes up this way and gets wider, kind of pulls out towards that way. Go back to her eyelash here, still using the dark combination of colors. If I can get this eye right, that will make me feel pretty good about the entire piece. 9:09, so about an hour. Hour in. Again, I'm erring on the side of the Alizarin Crimson in this blue-red mixture so that my shadows are nice and red. I'm almost using straight Alizarin Crimson for this particular stroke right here. I'm always checking what I'm doing. I'm kind of blurring my eyes out rather than back up, which is kind of impossible in this studio because all the stuff that we're redoing the basement and all the stuff that was in the basement or all my stuff that was in the basement is down in my studio, so backing up is kind of an impossibility right now. I'm just blurring my eyes so it kind of looks like I'm looking at it from far away. If I can get the same feeling that I get from when I look at the reference, then I know I'm on the right track. And it's getting there. Because I like that she's not looking at the camera in this particular image. I think it's kind of nice. just using whatever is left of the Gamsol that's currently on my palette as a thinner. This is pretty much straight red and blue, since both those colors are pretty fluid. I don't need to juice it up at all. So now, I'm going to keep this this brush as the brush with the dark combination on it. I'm going to use this brush to kind of mix in some light, so I'm going to be using two brushes at the same time, but they're both the same size. But one I'm going to try to keep dark, and one I'm going to try to use for the more sculptural highlights. Oftentimes I'm washing on brushes anyways, but... And just a note on washing out brushes, I'm not really going to be, especially in this painting, but often in professional jobs, I try not to wash out my brushes in Gamsol that often. What I'll do is I'll just mix it in with my linseed oil or whatever medium I'm using and kind of just wring it out on a cloth. Because especially if you're working on oil on board, the next, if you continuously wash out your brush with Gamsol or any kind of solvent, it's going to kind of affect the underlayers of the paint. You're going to pick up underlayers that you hadn't intended to, whereas if you just wash out your brushes with the medium and then kind of dab it on a cloth, your paint's going to build up a little more nicely. Now, in terms of highlights, where even though I'm adding this titanium white, but where I want like a highlight or something gets lighter, I'm gonna beef up the blue. So light is coming in and hitting the underside of her brow, kind of along the ridge of her eye socket. So that's going to be blue. And then the underside, as her eye socket kind of curves inwards towards the eyeball, it's still going to be, the value is still going to be lighter than like her eyelash, for instance, but it's going to be a warmer color. So start with a cool up here, underneath her brow, and then kind of move in. Kind of let your titanium white kind of blend in with the combination you already have. On the board. Alright, so I'm starting to get a good feeling about this eye. Doesn't look great, but I get a good feeling about it. As I said, this little speck of light is going to be blue, and this highlight is going to be blue. Her lid could go either way. I think what I'm going to do is I can move this closer. I'm going to give it a shot. I'm going to move the camera closer. But it's a little time delayed and I can't really see what's being displayed on the camera, so it'll be a little bit of a couple seconds to get this situated.
Sorry, people. Highlight our eyelid here. Not too much. And then the white of the eye is kind of a trick. It's never really white. In white, it's going to look a little less realistic. So try to make them as dark as you can. In this instance, I'm squinting my eyes and trying to get the feeling of the weight of the eye rather than trying to draw it in. Ethan is asking if I've ever had an unpleasant experience with any of my assignments. Yes. I mean, it's a job, so not every day is going to be a winner. But generally, everybody that I've worked with has been really great. People that art directors that I may have disagreed with generally have been right in hindsight. So fortunately, I've been smart enough to kind of know when to shut up and just kind of cut the art director some slack, and also recognize that they know a little bit more about what other people are going to read about your work. You're a little too close, and so they're giving an outside perspective, which is extremely important and useful. All right. Now the main forms are built up around the eye, so I'm going to try to determine distance between her eye here and the inside of her other eye socket. I just dipped this brush briefly in some linseed oil, just so I can draw a little bit here. Because this current drawing of the of her left eye to our right is a little too low, so using just titanium white and the combination of paints that are pretty much already on the canvas. I'm going to redraw some things here. Figuring out where the underside of her brow is. Now I'm switching to a larger brush. I'm gonna continue working around the face a little bit more. Throwing some blue in the forehead. I'm going to work on the value, or the value of her cheek versus the value of the hair that's kind of coming across her eye. Always squinting my eyes to try to see this from a farther distance optically. Alright, I'm washing this brush in Gamsol, dabbing it on my rag, because I'm going to go back and paint these magenta highlights in her hair. Just to give me an idea about how magenta it actually is. Because I'm going to start putting in the Naples yellow. So now it's time to mix in some of the Naples yellow. I'm just going to tape up this reference again so I don't need to hold it. Thank you.
So this is what my palette currently looks like.
I'm going to radiate out towards the, from the eye again. This time, trying to get correct color. Because right now it's all purple. Some places I want to remain that way, but the skin I think I want to lighten. Or not lighten, sorry. Lighten and add some yellow. So we're just going to do that. We're going to add some yellow to this light mixture. And even I don't need to mix it this much. I can just probably add it to the face. Because right now, if this streak of hair coming down her face is magenta, I'm just going to compare it to what I'm adding now. If I isolate it, that's pretty close. So what I'm doing is I'm just creating a pinhole with my hand, kind of looking at through the pinhole, and then comparing that pinhole shot to what's on the reference, and that's pretty darn close. But, as I mentioned, I'm working pretty much exclusively on this eye as a point of reference, and then that can rest of this is going to remain wet long enough that I don't need to worry too much about it. So if I can work this eye to a point where it's complete, that's going to inform the bridge of the nose, the other eye, tip of the nose, down to the mouth and chin. And then pretty much else, everything else will just be, I was going to say paint by numbers, but that's not the case. But at least you have a point of reference in the eyeball to work from. Weirdly, I'm kind of going back to something that I was avoiding initially, which is a warm highlight and cool highlight and a warm shadow. I'm kind of going back to a warm highlight and a cool shadow by adding this yellow. But in order to get the color right, it's kind of required. But that's okay. Things change. At least this highlight will then make her cheeks look nice and red, so that's nice by comparison. Adding the Naples yellow and more titanium white where I think the painting needs to get lighter based on the reference. And I'm also the color I'm basing off of this streak of hair that comes across her eye, I want to be pretty much pure magenta. So the color, I'm kind of basing off of that. Like right now I can tell that her eyebrow is going to be kind of on the cool side, as is the rest of her eye, apparently. Yeah, Sam just mentioned how different the piece looks with just a little bit of yellow, and that's true. I haven't used that much, but since the underpainting was basically all purple and yellow is the complementary color to purple, it's going to make a huge difference. So huge that I'm using it extremely sparingly still, because I don't want to warm this piece up too much. I want it to remain cool. But adding a third color is going to make it no longer monochromatic, and you're going to be able to create all sorts of naturalistic effects. If you're overseas and this is getting way too late for you, this will be archived. On my YouTube channel, so you guys can go to bed. I'll stop it at 3 hours, because that's the time limit, but if it's not done, then I'll just, I might not do a time lapse, but I might do just kind of a recap or something. Alright, so let's go back to the eye. Switching back to my darker brush that I've been using for drawing in a sec. Yeah, I currently live in Barrington, Rhode Island, which is a suburb of Providence. Grew up in Connecticut. Went to school in Rochester, New York. The Rochester Institute of Technology. Majored in illustration. thanks for hanging out with me, guys. This is great. Sam, Barrington is your hometown? Is the school system good? We came here for the school system. So it better be. So if I do rinse off the brush, I'll go back and dip it in the linseed oil and then kind of wipe it on the cloth, just to make sure I'm not going back with pure Gamsol onto the painting, so that my brush has a little, so I can build up the paint a little bit. So I'm not going back with pure thinner, I'm going back with a little bit of medium. Dragon is asking how the weather is in the States. We actually didn't get hit too hard by that huge storm that came through. For once, Boston and Rhode Island were spared. We only got a couple inches in it. It's pretty much all melted at this point. So we're not snowed in like last year. I don't know if you can see, but I went back and made that white of her eye more dark because I felt it was overpowering. Sorry I'm spending so much time on this eye. It's just
super critical.
But I appreciate you guys sticking with me. Trying to make her eyes some sort of a dark brown by mixing all three colors together, because that's what you're going to get if you mix all three colors. It's kind of a brown. So let's see if we can do that. And now she looks cross-eyed. Good job, Ryan. You guys are crazy, staying up so late with me. It's just all about placing the center of her eye in the right position. Moving it left or right. You guys are crazy. Dominic, what are you painting? think, a question about our brushes. I think these are called Bristol-on, so I assume these are bristle brushes. So I use those for laying in paint occasionally, but a lot of this finesse work is largely done with the soft hair. Brushes. Oh man. Okay. Jacob is asking what my other clients are besides MTG. Not much. I've done a few covers for Nightshade books over the years. Love to have more clients, but Magic is pretty much the only one. Has been the one that's really given me consistent work. I don't think I've screwed up too many jobs for those other clients, but so I'm just really grateful that Magic hires it keeps coming back. But back in my but I did at one point do a Broadway musical poster. It was for the Neil Simon plays Broadway Bound and Brighton Beach Memoirs. And so my art was really big on Broadway, which was cool to go down and see. But the show ended early, maybe because of my illustration. Probably not. But it was cool to see that day, because that was fun. It was back in 2009. And really, I'd love to expand out of the fantasy genre, but right now it just hasn't happened. The colonial pieces are all, colonial and the western pieces are all, personal projects. I would love to do historical fantasy. I don't know why I haven't been asked to do more of that. But, yeah, I would love to do more of that stuff professionally. It's just whether there's not a market for it, or whether they already have the people that do publish that kind of stuff, already have go-to artists that they use. I don't know, but all right, let's switch to a larger brush. And some more of this yellow. too much yellow there. Thanks for checking in, Dom. As I said, this will be archived on my YouTube account, so you can come by and check it when it's done. All right, so now I'm not 100% certain about these colors, so I'm going to switch gears and start on the hair, do that area, and then kind of come back down. Let me just soften some shadows here. Going back to the hair. Here we go. So, start with the darks again. Using a lot of the alizarin crimson here. And trying to use the darks selectively so as not to pick up some of the titanium white that I've already laid down. Now I'm going to dip my brush in some linseed oil and loosen this up even more. Some of the highlights in her hair are artificial highlights, meaning they're colors, and some are highlights that are created by light hitting her hair. The part where her hair is a more natural color, the highlights are blue, but they're not as blue as I've been making them. So I'm kind of toning the blue down with some of the Naples yellow. try to get a more naturalistic color here. It looks closer to being right, I guess. So the questions are, any tips for painting hair? Good reference is the main thing. Not painting every strand, but dealing with the shapes that are created by multitudes of hair. So you're dealing with forms rather than individual strands. And you can create individual strands by using your brushwork, and especially brushes like these, which are kind of broken up. You can create the illusion of multiple strands of hair, like letting your brush kind of play a little bit. Right now, I'm not too thrilled with how this is going. Maybe it's nerves, I don't know. Being selective with highlights is another thing you can think about. Starting with a dark color, or dark, much darker than you need to, and then working lighter. And some of you are asking about Patreon. I was thinking about Patreon at one point, but I just don't have enough to offer on a monthly or weekly basis to, because I'm not sure if this streaming thing is going to be something that I'm going to do all the time, because I do have a family, and they take precedence in addition to my other work that I need to get done, so I don't know if I can ethically take people's money and not offer much in return. I guess I like Gumroad. That's like, all right, it's a one-time thing where it's, you like, if you want the product, you can buy the product, and I'm appreciative of everybody that's done that, but I feel more comfortable going that route. Yeah, I'm kind of, just flying by the seat of my pants at this point. I'm trying to cool down. I want to just try to color the background so that the face looks a little more natural by comparison, and then go back into the face. So I'm doing like a combination of all the colors here in the background. Top of her head's a little small, so I'm gonna fix that. That's the thing. If you need something to be greener, you just add more of the ultramarine blue and the Naples yellow. If you need something to be more purple, add more of the red-blue combination. And so I'm just kind of trying to figure that out. Because it is getting down to the wire, and I'm not anywhere close to as far as I thought I was going to be. That's the way it goes. A lot can be done with comparative color. You can make something that's a face that doesn't really look all that natural, make it look natural by adding different colors in the background. Like right now, I'm trying to make a purple face look warmer by adding like more greens in the background. Or, sorry, not warmer. But make it look a little less red, a little less purple. Then going back. Michael just said that it helps to watch me solve problems in real time, and right now I feel like I'm flailing pretty much. I'm glad that it's helping, but I kind of feel lost at this point. I wanted to stop at 3 hours. I'm gonna have to, but I might have to finish this up on a time lapse or something, because this is just not where I wanted it to be at this point, but such is life. Streaming has turned out to be a lot harder than I thought it was going to be. No wonder not a lot of people do it. The lizard in crimson is really overpowering too. I hadn't anticipated that. play up the other colors in the face so that the alizarin crimson and the hair popped, but I didn't do that, so now I'm kind of fighting it back the other way. So I probably should have taken one challenge at a time. Rather than try to do a random palette and my first stream, rather than should have just done a palette that I was familiar with. But oh well, this is fun. Because if we're going to be poor, I might as well have fun, I guess. Yeah, now my palette is a complete mess. I'm just kind of throwing stuff at this palette now, or at this painting. Just get her eyes right. The rest of it would just kind of fall into place, but
can do is laugh.
Thank you, everybody, for your support. This is not my best night of painting that I've ever had, but I've learned a lot. I've learned that streaming is very, very difficult. I mentioned earlier. Not being a very good recital player when I took piano lessons as a kid. And this has turned out to be very similar. And also, I learned that a limited palette or a random palette is fun. But I completely overestimated the power of Alizarin Crimson. This is just a very intense red that I just hadn't anticipated. So now what I'm trying to do is get rid of some of it. And then I completely neglected the Naples yellow, for too long. And now it's like an emergency to get it back in, but lesson, it's a reminder about why I do color studies for my professional job, because this, if this were a professional job I would be doing it at like a 5x7, get it done real quick, realize that Alizarin Crimson was not the right color for me, and then just move on. But now I'm kind of fighting against it. So, when I shut off the cameras in 15 minutes, I don't know whether I'm gonna finish this, scrap it, or I don't know what, but I'm not gonna throw it away, but I mean, like, give up on it as a piece. Don't worry, Sam. That's the point of this little experiment, is that it's fun. It teaches me stuff too, because I learned now that, like, I know that Jeremy Wilson, the oil painter, he uses a lot of Alizarin Crimson in his work. He must have found a way to, like, harness it or something. But actually, what I'm doing here, the lips, has finally given me some sort of grasp into the color of this piece after 3 hours. Sheesh. because I didn't think I was going to use a lot of the Naples yellow, but it's turning out to be the savior, because these lips are okay. These lips are about the right color, which is strange because I haven't even been on the map for all this time. But it's because I just I didn't use that stupid Naples yellow enough. This, the lips in comparison to the color of the shadows is looking okay. So now if I had another 3 hours, you'd go back and work outward from the lips, you know, rather than from the eye, because eyes I didn't get right, so I can start with the lips, since I got the color of the lips right. Because part of painting is recognizing what you've done wrong, of course, but it's also about recognizing what you've done right. Should have just started with the chin, guys. Would have made things a lot easier, huh? Oh, man. Finally got something right. I only got 10 minutes left. Oh, well. Because I gotta go to bed. My son's gonna be up at 5 or 6 in the morning, so I've gotta get some sleep. He's stirring right now, so I hope he gets to that point. Anyways, well, it's about that time. Sorry, this is not a completed painting. this small section, her chin, is the right color. Everything else is kind of insane. So, I don't know what I'm going to do with this, the rest of it. So anyways, I really, really appreciate you guys sticking with me. It's been a learning experience. I hope to do it again. Hope to get better at it. And everybody out there, I hope you keep painting. Yeah, this is just super frustrating. Oh well. Anyways, hope you like this stream. Thanks for watching, and see you next time.